Thank you here for the invitation. This is a lovely place to be. I'm going to talk a little bit about a complicated type B aortic dissection and if we should treat them with TEVAR. I think that's a very hot topic in medicine recently. All the meetings, there's a lot of talk about this. And it's a conflict of interest. So first, we have to categorize what is like aortic dissections. We have this, can we say that acute is less than 14 days, chronic. Some people say greater than 14 days or 90 days, but there is this group of subacute that is 14 to 90 days. So with the instead, like the first 2 years, the follow-up, the complete data, as I call it, they actually had patients from 70 medical treated and 66 treated with medical management and TEVAR. But they were treated between week 2 and 1 year, so they're really not acute patients. And when you analyze the data, there is really no difference in mortality between the two groups. However, when you start digging a little bit more and you start looking at false lumen diameter, true lumen diameter, you know that there is a lot of variability in aortic remodeling. You also see that the false lumen thrombosis in most of the patients that require TEVAR. And once you start getting into the mortality, there were 11 mortalities in the trial, 4 in the optimal medical therapy, and they all comply with the inclusion criteria, and 7 in the ones that got TEVAR too. But when you start going into all the patients that were there, 4 of those patients had violation of the inclusion criteria. They were really non-complicated. They were complicated cases that were included in this trial. So if you exclude those patients, the mortality is actually the same. And so I was thinking, like, what do we do, and how do we treat our disease? In aneurysms, thoracoabdominal AAA, we treat them by natural history. A lot of these patients, we put them through a risk the first 30 days because we know that if the AAA is greater than 5.5, they have a higher risk of rupture. The same with carotid disease. We've been treating some asymptomatic carotid disease for a long time because we know that they will benefit from our intervention once they're greater than 80%. And in critical limb ischemia, patients that present with rest pain, we treat them, we do bypasses, we do all these interventions to try to prevent limb loss down the road. But we put them all through a higher risk procedure during the first month. So once we get these referrals, we've seen a lot of these pictures earlier today, those are very tough cases to deal with. Patients that have a aneurysmal degeneration and type B dissection. So there is a lot of people that fix it. There is some data in some centers, but these are very complex procedures. So when you start reviewing the literature in this, there is a systematic review of 19 studies, the mortality is not insignificant, it's 11% in the entire series, 7.5% in the more contemporary series, with higher risk of complications like stroke, renal failure, and spinal cord ischemia. And this is in centers that have like a big aortic program with larger volumes, and it's gonna be very difficult to reproduce those results in the also in endovascular management, with the clinic experience, 3 of their 356 patients done between 2006 and 2011 had chronic thoracic aortic dissection. And they have excellent results in terms of mortality, stroke, spinal cord ischemia, and renal failure. However, they have a very high reintervention rate. 67%, 7% of these patients require some type of endovascular repair. 40% of those patients treated with the extensive repair had some type of defect like Marfan syndrome or Lewy disc. So those patients tend to fail more than the other ones. So yeah, you can have patients like this and obtain results like this down the road, or another patient like this and obtain results like this, but these are patients that are going to require a lot of expertise from the people taking care of them, and they're going to have a lot of return. So once you get more into the Instell XL treatment and analysis, this is a 5-year follow-up, and we noted that patients that have a TEVAR done with the optimal medical therapy have a much better result in terms of mortality, aortic-related mortality, and progression of aneurysmal disease. And once you analyze the false lumen thrombosis, the partial thrombosis, how your aorta is remodeling, as well as expansion of the aorta. same. So there have been some reports in different factors that might predict some of the complications listed here. I'm going to go one by one. So if, when you have partial total thrombosis, no thrombosis at all, the post lumen, if you have partial thrombosis, you have some kind of coverage on some of the reentry axis. So your diastolic blood pressure is going to be much higher in those patients than in the ones that have no thrombosis at all or full thrombosis of the pulse. So that's going to lead an increase in the diameter of the aneurysm, and maybe it's going to have an effect in the mortality, long-term mortality of those patients that have partial thrombosis. Also, the entry tear has been found that is very important. If you have a larger entry tear, greater than 10 millimeters, and is proximal entry tear, those tend to have a lower survival down the road when compared to the other groups that have a smaller entry tear or more distant. The total aortic diameter has been found to be very important, and there is a higher number of aortic events in patients that present with aneurysm greater than 4 centimeters at initial presentation. Initial is anywhere between, like, initial presentation or 6 weeks. The false lumen diameter has been also found to be of some importance in these patients. Greater than 22 millimeters, they don't have an event-free survival. It tends to dilate, and we said earlier, leads to complications related to the aortic pathology. So, in some conclusions, you know, like optimal medical therapy fails to prevent long-term aortic complications. TVAR has improved, you know, since we started to do this trial. Right now, there's new devices, new delivery system. The profile has improved dramatically. We know a lot how to prevent some of the complications. And it's clearly associated with some type of aortic remodeling based on the results of the listed trial. So I think what we need to do as a group of doctors is identifying those patients that have a high risk factor, and that intervention will prevent this aortic degeneration and all the complications associated with this really complex disease like abdominal aneurysm. So the question is, should we do a randomized controlled trial? There is some effort right now to get a trial going. It's going to be a very expensive trial, and there is a lot of government funding that has been looked upon to get this going. So, and I think intervention in this particular group of patients will probably lead to better long-term outcomes. So then the question, if we treat them with TVAR at this point, I don't know, but I think we need to find the patients